Hello everyone, welcome to this session. So just a quick introduction on Augury to start with. So Augury started in 2014. It's a technology that is integrated in more than 10,000 apps. Augury gets access to more than 400 million unique user profiles that all consented to share their data. Okay, Augury is fully GDPR compliant since the beginning in 2014. Which means that all the data that we analyze and generate is coming from consented users, so they accepted to share the data that we use. We are trusted by more than 900 premium brands, and we'll discuss in this presentation how we manage to work with those brands and how you can benefit as a mobile publisher from those brands that we work with. We are a bit more than 220 employees now in five countries, in the UK, in France, in Italy, in Spain and in the US, where we've got six offices in the US, and from the beginning we raised a bit more than $30 million. Just to give you an idea of the size of the company, we are going to make a bit more than $100 million in revenue this year. Our specialty is mobile journey marketing. What is that? So basically, today most organizations have only visibility into their users, what happens in their apps. Okay, you know through CRM what your users are doing, how much time they spend in your own apps, but you don't know what happens outside of your app. Okay, you don't see the entire mobile journey of the users that you have in your app, and you don't know what they do outside of your app. Okay, at Augury, we analyze, again on consented users, all the apps that they have installed on their phones, the apps that they use, the apps that they uninstalled, and the websites that they browse. Okay, this allows us, Augury, to see the entire mobile journey on the phones and to turn those data into insights and those insights into actions. Okay, we allow marketers and publishers to take actions from the insights that we collect from the users. Okay, for marketers, we've got a full suite of solutions, but today we are here to talk about the solutions for publishers. Those solutions are four different solutions. The first one is the consent managers. Okay, you all know about GDPR. You now need to be compliant with the law and to ask your users permission before gathering any kind of data. And you need to tell them how and why you take this data. Okay, to do that, you need a solution that allows you to take this data, to share and to optimize the number of the percentage of opt-in rates that you will have in your app. And this is what we allow to do. So you can fully customize the buttons, the color, the text that you will display to your users to make sure that they understand, again, the reason why you collect data, but also that you can optimize the opt-in rate. Okay? Every percentage that you optimize in the opt-in rate of your users brings more revenue. Okay? And an opt-in users bring you much more revenue than an opt-out users. And we will discuss about this later. So this is the first solution that we provide, a consent manager solution. The second one is AdInCube Intelligent Mediation. That is a mediation solution that puts in competition every kind of demand source to make sure that you, as a publisher, benefit from all the demand sources and that you can put in competition performance ad networks, for example, as well as RTB demand partners. The second one is our exclusive demand that we have, that is only premium brand demand, and we'll see a bit later in the presentation today how we manage to attract those premium brands into games. And the fourth solution is Active Insight, that is an app ecosystem intelligence solution that allows you to take insight, to get insights on your apps and your any competitor's apps, and to turn those insights into actions. Today we are here to talk about what you value most, your users, and how to manage to increase the user engagement and the monetization. Okay, the first tip is that you need to understand your users' entire mobile user journey and to turn insights into actions. Okay, if we are all here today in this room and in this conference, it's because we all know that the mobile gaming industry is booming. Okay, it's going to represent more than 50% of the entire gaming industry. So mobile is definitely where players are playing, actually, on their mobile devices. And just this year, there will be more than 200 million users in the US only playing regularly games, so at least once a week. So the trend is there. And there is clearly a trend on the casual games as well that changes the behavior and the profile of the users. we see that the users are no longer like male teenagers playing zombie games in their garage, but we've got more and more females. More than 50% of the casual gamers are female, and we see in this chart that is coming from an exclusive research that we did at Augury based on the behavior of the users, that you've got, in terms of age repartition, you've got more than 50% of the casual gamers that are between 35 and 54 years old. Okay, so this is real different compared to what the industry is usually thinking about the gamers, and I'm sure that as publishers you all know that, but clearly I took a screenshot of the top rankings this morning on iOS and on Android. The trend is there. Okay, this is the top three games on iOS and on Android, and you see that most of them are casual or hyper casual games. Okay, there is Fortnite of course on the iOS ranking, but that's more an exception if you look at the top 10. And again, this was this morning, so the trend is there, and it's not going to stop. Okay, because this usage of the casual gaming is going along with the fact that users are more and more multitasking on their phones. When you start using a game, actually, you will, in the same mobile session, use probably other games. Okay, compared to last year, there is an increase of 10% of the number of users that use more than four apps in the same mobile session. So you take your phone, and in the same session, you are going to use more than four apps, and the number of apps increases year after year. So you use four apps, but you also use more and more games. Okay, we did a specific research that shows that on a specific game, okay, a casual game, 56% of those users during the same day played another game from another studio. And one third of those users of this specific game used a third game from a third studio. Okay, so the players are moving from one game to another one, and not necessarily in the same studios. Okay, so your users are switching from one app to another, but also from one game to another, including your competitors' games. We did the research on some specific apps, and here we've got the names. So, for example, if I look at the Battlelands Royale players, okay, and I will look at the players who didn't play the games during the last 10 days. Okay, so here we are not talking about players who are going to use several games in the same day, but players who stopped using a game. Okay, so Battlelands Royale users who didn't play this game during 10 days, during the same 10 days, 86% of those players played Clash Royale. So when a user stops using your game, he may start using another game, or he may keep using another game. And that's something that you need to understand very specifically to understand the behavior of your users. It's not only your game that sometimes is not good enough in terms of retention. It's also the fact that sometimes they discover another game and they start using it, and they keep using it after discovering it. So inactive users on your games are not necessarily inactive in other games. Okay, and here you've got several examples. If I take Guns of Boom online shooter, for example, there are 10% of the users that didn't play this game during 10 days, that during the same 10 days played Candy Crush Saga. Okay, so this is very concrete example, okay, that we did on our exclusive research on the fact that users stop playing a game and start playing another game. And this is something that you can see with our Active Insight platform. Here is a screenshot of our platform that I did just a couple of days ago for Magic Tiles 3 compared with Piano Tiles 2. Okay, just to look at the cross-app usage during those two games that are published by two different studios. Okay, they've got 7.5% users in common. It's called Active Insight because what you can do is that you can extract the common users that you have in your app with any other apps in the market. To do what? For example, to re-engage with those users. Okay, you see that one portion of your users started to download another app. Okay, what it means is that you can see the behavior that they start to have and the fact that some of them will stop using your app to start using another one. So it's maybe time to extract those IDs and to engage with them through push notifications, through re-engagement, through advertising, just to make sure that you don't let them go out of your app. Okay. What it means as well is that sometimes in your game, you advertise for direct competitors' games. Okay, if you see that some players stop using your game to start playing another one, maybe you should think, okay, why am I still advertising for this competitor? Okay, I'm not saying here that we should stop advertising for other games, but some specific games have a very bad impact, very negative impact on your users' retention. You need to identify them and to make sure that you blacklist those games. This is very specific, and you need insights to be able to do that, but you need also to understand that you fight every day to optimize the retention of your users, and in the same time, you advertise for direct competitors that are stealing users from your game. So that's something that you need to consider. Okay, this is what you see usually with any data company or any data solution. On the left-hand side is what we see. We see the entire mobile journey on your game, okay? All the other apps that the users have installed on their phones, the website that they browse, and you see how much time they spend in any specific app that you want to compare your game with, okay? And you can take those insights, turn those insights into actions. To do that, and that's the second tip, you need to diversify also the sources of demand. Okay, I know, and we all know here, that advertising is the main source of revenue for most of the games around here. It's more than 50% of the revenue for the games, and it's even higher in the casual games. This is a study from last year from AdColony. So you see that video ads, display ads, native ads are more than 50%, and in-app purchases are a bit less than 40%. So advertising is key in your monetization strategy. And it's very hard to know what players you should work with. We are all contacted by many, many, and several advertising partners that all claim to have the best fill rate, highest CPM possible on the market, and it's very hard to choose amongst them. And sometimes what studios and publishers end up by doing is that they just pick one or two, three, five maximum that are the usual players, and they keep working with them. And the fact is that actually by doing so, you miss opportunities. The top players of yesterday are not necessarily the top players of today or tomorrow, and some of them are not always relevant for your specific type of audience, specific geos or format that you have. So you need to be ready to diversify your sources of demand. Okay, for example, when you've got an ad request to send, you need to make sure that you ask and you have in your mix bidders like RTB players, programmatic players, as well as classic ad networks or marketplaces. Okay, and you need to put all of those players in competition all together to make sure that, again, you don't miss any opportunity. This diversification of revenue is something that you need to do, and you need to put them in competition for every ad request. You need to challenge your waterfall every day and to make sure that you've got the technology that allows you to do that in the same time as blacklisting the direct competitors that you may have in your app. Okay, so putting in competition RTB demand players with classic demand partners, okay, is something that you can do through prediction technology, for example, that allows you to predict the CPM and to make sure that for every ad request, you can put them in competition. That's key, again, to make sure that you don't miss any opportunity and that you serve every ad at the highest price and that you can get demand coming from RTB sources as well as classic SDK ad networks in the market. Third tip, you need to make sure that you attract premium brands. Easy to say, everyone would like to have a premium brands in their games. Not always easy to do. Okay, so that's what we do at Augury. We make sure that the premium brands can start to spend in the games. How do we do that? Not just because we are nice, but because we show them some data and insights that they can activate on their side as well. Okay, so this is just another example of a view that we have on Active Insights that is called App Universe. It shows the apps that are used in the same context of a specific app. Here, I took the example of a game called World Flowers. It's a puzzle game. And you see all the apps that are used in the same context. And there are two apps, one called Telegraph, the other one called BBC News, that are used by the same users. Okay, this is just an example, and that illustrates the fact that the players of this game are the same as the readers of BBC News or the Telegraph. When we go after the brands and we convince them to target, for example, the players who want to buy a Rolex, and we say to them that they can of course target them in Telegraph or BBC News if they want, but they can also find the same users in a game like Wildflowers. And this is what we do. We manage through the data to convince those brands to advertise in any kind of app, including gaming apps. And this is, again, a view that you can access to in Active Insight, that is an entirely free solution that you can use for any kind of app, your apps and your competitor's app. This allowed us to work with, again, more than 900 brands. Here you've got some logos of the brands we managed to work with so far, and those brands advertise on any kind of apps, including casual game apps, hyper-casual game apps, and utility apps. So the data allows you as publishers to get access to those premium brands. If you look at the number of the kind of campaigns that you have in your apps, you need to wonder and to ask yourself, what is the proportion of premium brand campaigns that are running in your apps? If the answer is 0%, maybe you can do better than this, and you can start running premium brand campaigns in your games. Again, to make sure that you don't only advertise for other games and that you your app is associated with those premium brands that the consumers are interested in. Three main takeaways: understand your user's entire mobile journey and turn those insights into actions. Actions, again, can be extract those users, re-engage with them through CRM, and blacklist your direct competitors, apps, and advertisers. Diversify your sources of demand to make sure that you don't miss any opportunity. You work with RTB demand partners, as well as any kind of demand source, and that you put them in competition all together for every ad request. And the third takeaway is to make sure that you can leverage the data that you have to attract, finally manage to attract the premium brands that everyone wants to work with. That was it for my main takeaways. Thank you very much.
I have a question for you.
Yes.
You touched on this a little bit at the opening, but can you talk a little bit about how things have changed in the last couple of years with the shift towards hyper-casual and what that has meant for game developers?
It also goes along with the advertising evolution of the industry, I think, and the fact that there is always this balance that publishers need to find between like running too many ads and make sure that you monetize your users quickly enough, because we all know that the volatility between and the users that are using hyper-casual games is not the same as hardcore gamers or mid-core gamers, so that's something to take in account. But again, it goes with the fact that there are more and more players, and not the usual ones, not the hardcore ones. So you get access to more players, but those players are not as sticky as they can be in other types of games. And that's something that we all need to learn about and to deal with, and it changes the way we monetize our games. Less in-app purchase, more advertising, and in this advertising we need to find the right balance again between like too many ads, too intrusive, and making sure that you earn enough money with your games. That's a big challenge today for everyone.
Great, thanks Jules.
Thank you very much. Thank you.